So I'm thrilled to introduce to you this afternoon on the subject of Trumponomics, Dan Mitchell.
Well, thank you very much. I always enjoy the Steamboat Institute events, not just because I get a chance to speak, but it's great to hear all the other speakers and panels. Victor Davis Hanson did something I didn't think was possible. He made me semi-optimistic about the Trump years, because as you're going to see when I'm talking about fiscal policy, I have a pretty grim assessment of what's going to happen. As a matter of fact, if y'all thought that the foreign policy panel didn't have any good answers, are there any like sharp knives on the tables? Well, you're going to be gnawing through your wrists with your teeth by the time I get done. I have a PowerPoint presentation, a lot of slides. I'm going to go through them fairly quickly. But if you actually want the presentation, just give me your card or something like that. I'll email it to you. Or I'm sure Jennifer or somebody with the Steamboat staff can get it to you. But what I want to do is talk about what I think is a great unknown. What is Trump going to do on the economy? And I'll start by noting that the Economic Freedom of the World Index, published by the Fraser Institute, and the Index of Economic Freedom, published by the Heritage Foundation, they both basically agree on what the recipe is for economic growth. You have to get five things right: monetary policy, trade policy, regulatory policy, rule of law, which we just heard about on that last panel, and fiscal policy. That's what I specialize in, much to my great misery. And so what I'm going to do is walk through what we know about Trump on these issues and where we think he might take the country. On monetary policy, this is one of the question marks. He didn't really address that issue at all during the campaign. And of course, he doesn't have a long track record. He hasn't been a politician casting votes on things. He hasn't been writing policy papers. So we don't really know what he thinks about monetary policy. But there are a couple of question marks. First of all, do we have a Fed-induced bubble in our economy right now? If we do, does Trump have any views on how we should sort of unwind that bubble without causing some sort of recession or some sort of a 2008-style financial crisis? We simply don't know. But if I was Donald Trump, or if I was Bannon or Kellyanne Conway or any of those people, I would be worrying about that. Because if there is a bubble and it pops while Trump is in the White House, guess who probably gets the blame? Trump. Even though it's the Fed under Obama, for that matter going all the way back to Bush, that's had this easy money philosophy, Trump will be the one holding the bag when all of a sudden everything goes south. So I guess with monetary policy, put down a question mark. We don't know. I don't know. I guess we won't know anything until we see him make a couple of appointments. There are two open spots on the Board of Governors of the Fed, and there'll probably be several more during Trump's tenure. So we'll have to see what he does on that. On trade policy, this is not a question mark, unfortunately. He's not a free trader. And free trade is a good thing. And if you look at his appointments, there are three main appointments on trade. They're all protectionist. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that he'll do protectionist policy. It could simply mean that he won't continue with the sort of post-World War II consensus of liberalizing trade. In other words, TPA, TTIP, all those things are now off the table. But if that's the only thing that happens, that's not that bad, because we've had a lot of trade liberalization over the last 50, 60 years, and if all we do is basically tread water for 4 years or 8 years, I can live with that. The problem is whether Trump decides he's going to try to actually unwind NAFTA or pull us out of the WTO. If he starts doing things like that and running the risk of a global trade war, that is not going to be good for the economy. And it's not just whether or not you're an exporter that it's bad. It's simply bad for growth and prosperity in general. Open competitive markets and trade make our economy more efficient and help us to grow faster, regardless of whether or not you're actually involved in the import or export business yourself. So this is sort of a minus, but we don't know how big of a minus it is. What about the rule of law? Well, we just spent 8 years of Mr. Pen and a phone. And when Obama said that, I don't think people realized how wrong that was. He was saying it didn't matter what the Constitution required in terms of the promulgation of law, the passage of law, the signing of laws. Obama was just going to unilaterally change policy. Now, the good news is the court struck him down a lot. But the mere fact that we had such an uncertain regulatory and legal environment because Obama was in effect going rogue, it's very good to see that in the rearview mirror. But what do we know about Trump? Well, we don't know a lot about what he feels on these issues. He criticized some of the stuff Obama did, but does he intend to do the same thing himself? Now, he's already gotten in trouble for his executive orders, but I think mostly because maybe they weren't drafted as tightly as they should have been. I mean, one of the things about the Trump administration is he has something like, what, 3,000 to 4,000 political appointees, almost 1,000 of which require Senate confirmation. I think he's only gotten 16 of them through, although that's a couple of days ago. Maybe we had a couple of people get confirmed. But there's a giant amount of staff that he still doesn't have. And so when he tries to do things, he's either relying on just a handful of aides who might not have expertise in that area, or is relying on the bureaucracy, which of course is not going to be friendly for the most part to what he's trying to do. Now, Trump does have a high opinion of himself, like Obama. So he might be tempted to do a little bit of pen and phone stuff himself. But the bottom line is, just like on monetary policy, I don't really know what Trump's going to do. Except I'll say this, his appointments, I suspect, will be much, much better about respecting the rule of law. So I guess actually it's a small plus. I don't know about Trump himself, but his appointments will be pretty good. Regulatory policy, I think, is an area where we're going to see a plus. You look at people, I mean, the panel that just got off was talking about people like Pruitt. Unquestionable improvement in terms of this mentality that the Obama people had, that the private economy was something bad that had to be smothered and regulated and controlled. The good news is, I think Trump sensibly understands, perhaps from all his years as being a developer, where I'm sure he had to deal with lots of regulatory hassles, Trump, I think, gets it at some sort of instinctive, visceral level, and I think his appointees are, by and large, going to reflect that, and so we should have a much better thing to watch. Two things, though, I would specifically call your attention to. Who is going to run OIRA? That's the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs at OMB, Office of Management and Budget. That's a tremendously important position because that's, in effect, the gatekeeper or the cop for the entire regulatory process of the executive branch. If Trump puts in someone very good at OIRA, that will be very, very good news. Because we've seen this before with Republican administrations. No matter how good their appointments are in the different bureaucracies, what oftentimes happens is they get captured. They go native, it's being called. And so the bureaucracy sort of woos them and sort of slowly seduces them until they sort of, it's sort of like Stockholm Syndrome, the political equivalent of that. And so it's very important that you have someone good at OIRA. And then the other thing to watch, will Trump back his people? When Pruitt, as the panel was talking about, starts doing good things, I can guarantee you, I've been in Washington 3 decades, you are going to have the left-wing bureaucrats at EPA leaking all sorts of information to the Washington Post and the New York Times. There are going to be stories on the network news, on CNN, about, oh, Scott Pruitt doing this crazy thing. Scott Pruitt wants children to be poisoned, so on and so forth. The easy thing for Trump to do will be to pull cut his legs out from under him, pull the stool away, whatever metaphor you want to use. That would be the easy thing for Trump to do. And if Trump does that a couple of times, guess what? Pruitt and the other good people who get appointed are going to learn a lesson. We can't be aggressive. We have to make our peace with the bureaucracy. In effect, we have to let the deep state continue to run things. So Trump has to back his people up when they get the inevitable attacks that come with doing something good. Will he do that? I mean, the one amazing thing about Trump is he is, unlike most Republicans, when most Republicans get attacked, they sort of curl up in a fetal position, and they say, oh, please stop kicking me. Trump counterpunches. Now, he might not always be counterpunching on the thing I want him to counterpunch on, but he does counterpunch, and if he backs up his people, that will be a very positive sign for the country. What about my issue? What about fiscal policy? Well, first, let's get a couple of principles out there. We have a spending problem. And by the way, I want to stress something. We don't have a deficit and debt problem. The deficit and debt are symptoms of the real problem of government spending. If I go to the doctor because I have headaches, And the doctor, you know, does all these CAT scans and MRIs, and he comes back to me and says, Dan, you have a brain tumor. Am I going to say to the doctor, well, can you give me some aspirin for this headache? Well, actually, I probably will. It's no fun to have a headache, but guess what my number one priority is going to be? Can you somehow get this tumor out of my head? That's the way we need to think about fiscal policy. We have a problem with a government that is too big, that is doing things that our founding fathers never intended, doing things that don't make economic sense, doing things that are counterproductive for our economy. And we need to figure out how to slow down and constrain the growth of government spending so that the private sector can flourish. And that's going to mean dealing with entitlements. And this is where I get a little bit nervous. During the campaign, Trump said he doesn't want to deal with entitlements. Trump is, if he's serious about that, he is like a Greek politician in 2005 saying, everything is fine, we don't need to have to worry about anything. That would not be a very responsible position to take. And by the way, if Trump wants his tax cuts, there's no way those will be sustainable or durable unless we figure out some way to take that cost curve of government spending and bend it down a little bit. Now, the good news, I don't think Trump is serious about his entitlement statements during the campaign. He can't be. It's a matter of math. I mean, if you look at our demographics, you look at the forecast, there's no way a serious person who cared about the future of the country would say no to entitlement reform. I mean, heck, even Hillary Clinton said yes to entitlement reform, the wrong kind. She always wanted to raise taxes, but at least she realized there was a math problem. The private economy is growing this fast. The entitlement programs are growing that fast. That's a recipe, again, for fiscal disaster. Now, she had the wrong medicine that she wanted to give us, but at least she understood that something had to happen. Now, I mentioned that we've had some good appointments in the regulatory field. I'm very happy that Congressman Mulvaney is at the Office of Management and Budget. And I know that some of the people that he has on board and some of the White House staffers, these are some of the people I've been working with for 15, 20, 25 years. And they are serious people who want to do the right thing. But of course, ultimately, Trump makes the decisions. So we have to wait and see. And oh, by the way, the Treasury and National Economic Council appointees, the two Goldman Sachs guys, I have no idea whether they're good or bad. Trump basically hired a couple of very smart, capable, intelligent people from Wall Street. But we had a very smart, capable, intelligent person from Wall Street in Hank Paulson. What did he do? He gave us TARP. We had a very smart, intelligent, capable person from Wall Street, another Goldman Sachs guy, Steve Friedman, National Economic Council under Bush. Did he do anything? No. I mean, he didn't do something bad like Paulson, but he didn't do anything good. So what really needs to happen, I'm sure these people are immensely capable of doing good things, but Trump has to give them very clear marching orders. If he gives them very clear marching orders, I'm sure they are people who can do the right thing. But if he basically says, oh, hey, I appointed you guys, figure something out, I'm not confident based on, in the past, when we've had business and Wall Street guys go into government, again, that problem of sort of the career bureaucracy and the Washington establishment sort of capturing people. It's sort of like, what's the Star Trek thing? You get assimilated by the Borg. It's sort of what happens to people in Washington if they don't go into town with a very strong, clear set of principles. So here are the questions that Trump has to decide. Will he be serious about spending? Second, he has to reduce the size of his tax cut. Now, I hate saying that. I've never met a tax cut I don't like. I agree with Milton Friedman on that. But from a political realism perspective, his tax cut was $10 trillion over 10 years. That's just not going to fly, especially if he's not being overly aggressive on spending. So he has to reduce the size of his tax cut, and then he has to figure out how to mesh it with what the House of Representatives has proposed. Now, what about Trump's tax plan in specific? Some great stuff. 15% top corporate rate, 25% top personal rate, death tax repeal, lower business tax rates for small businesses. But as I said, it's a giant tax cut. I mean, it's so big that even I can't foresee a way that it could possibly happen. Now, I mentioned already you have differences with the House plan. The House plan is better in two ways. Expensing, which basically means you're not taxing new investment. And by the way, it's absolutely crazy that we have a tax code that penalizes people for new investment. I mean, it's one of the most insane, foolish things that a tax system could ever have. So the House plan has expensing, and it also has no worldwide taxation. We're one of the few countries in the world that actually taxes our companies when they're trying to compete in foreign markets and earn market share. And let's remember, those companies that are competing in foreign markets are already being taxed by those foreign governments. And yet, we have a tax system that says, oh, we're going to add another layer of tax on top of what the foreign governments are taxing you, and all your competitors from Germany and other countries, they don't pay that extra layer of tax. I mean, it's not just shooting yourself in the foot, it's like taking a chainsaw and sawing off your foot. So that's a very good feature of the House plan. But the Trump plan is better than the House plan in a couple of ways. There are lower tax rates, and there's no risk of a VAT. And this is this border adjustable provision that we already heard about from Congressman Nunez. The House Ways and Means guys are trying to do the right thing. I worry, though, what happens in 4 or 8 years if we have President Elizabeth Warren? And if you put in a border adjustable provision that isn't that different from a value-added tax, the left has been salivating and fantasizing about adding a value-added tax on top of our income tax for decades. And so I never want to do anything, even if it's by well-meaning people who would never do it themselves, I never want to do anything that might open up the possibility of a value-added tax in America. I mean, we'll be France then. Then we have to train our army to surrender if there's ever a war. It'd just be a big pain in the neck. We don't want to do that. So the ideal situation would be to take the best features of the House plan and the best features of the Trump plan and merge them together. But you know what? Instead of a $10 trillion Trump tax cut, you probably then have a $12 trillion tax cut. So somehow we have to mesh these things together while also scaling back dramatically what's in the Trump plan. But none of that is going to happen unless we deal with government spending. Government spending is the fiscal problem. Matter of fact, one of the few things I want to achieve in Washington, I don't expect this will happen, but I want every Republican politician fitted with a shock collar. You know, like you have a dog in a yard. And every time a Republican politician says, we need to fix our debt or deficit problem, I want them to get a shock. Oh, well, and then they'll remember, oh, we need to fix our spending problem. Because you know what happens when you say we need to fix our debt problem? Chuck Schumer raises his hand and says, I'll help you. I have this big giant list of tax increases right here, and it'll be, you know, pulling out a list about a mile long. If you properly identify that we have a spending problem, it then makes it harder for Chuck Schumer and the rest of the crazies to start pushing their tax increase agenda. And if you really wanted to find good policy, what is success? Well, I'm a libertarian. I fantasize about cutting government spending. But you know what? We don't have to meet that fantasy. All we need to do to make progress over time is to simply have government grow slower than the private sector. You guys in business understand that trend lines are important. If you're losing money every year at a certain rate, that's a very bad trend line. If you're making money every year at a certain rate, that's a very good trend line. We have a very bad trend line in fiscal policy in America. Government spending year after year, not every year because you have ups and downs, but over the long run, the average has been for government to grow faster than the private sector. And that means more and more of the productive resources of our country are being consumed by government spending instead of being in the private sector. Will they be used more productively? And as I mentioned, because of the entitlement programs, and if you have that increase in government over a long period of time growing faster than the private sector, you become Greece. My buddy Art Laffer is famous for the Laffer curve, and I'll talk about that in a few minutes. I decided to make myself famous. Nobody's going to make me famous, so I'm making myself famous with something I call Mitchell's Golden Rule. But set aside the fact that I'm putting my name on it, I actually think it is a very sensible policy. Simply have the private sector grow faster than the government, or if you know, you glass half full, half empty, have the government grow slower than the private sector. Whichever way you want to look at it, that's really the key over time. If your tax revenues are growing 5% a year, how do you make progress? You have government grow less than 5% a year. If the private economy is growing 5% a year, how do you gradually shrink the burden of government spending? You have government grow by less than that. It's really a very simple proposition.
Now, of course, that's not where we are right now. We've had 8 years, actually, the whole 21st century has been subpar growth. We had a couple of good years in the middle part of last decade, but that was a little bit false because we had the housing bubble caused by the Fed and Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. So yeah, we had growth, but I'm not sure I would really endorse that type of growth. So we have something that some people call secular stagnation. I just call it Europeanization. For the entire 21st century, including under George W. Bush, good thing about working at a libertarian think tank, I have no hesitation in blaming people who deserve blame. So for the entire 21st century, government's been growing, the private sector's being hammered, and is it any surprise that we're growing 2% a year this century when the historical average in the United States is more like 3 to 3.5%? We become more like France and Italy and Greece, we start having more like France, Italy, and Greece growth numbers. No big mysteries there. And you see it, by the way, I mentioned at the start, the Economic Freedom of the World Index. In 2000, we were the third freest economy in the world, behind only Hong Kong and Singapore. Now, I think in the last rating, we're down to number 16. I mean, by global standards, that's still pretty good. We're obviously ahead of France and Italy and some of these countries, and ahead of almost everybody in the developing world, but that's still a big drop. We've been moving in the wrong direction. So we have to change, at least in terms of the government spending variable, we have to change that trajectory of government spending, and a lot of it is driven by demographics. Our population is aging. As a matter of fact, I have something here to underscore this. You all probably remember in school or someplace learning about the population pyramid. You know, a few old people at the top of the pyramid, then a big generation of workers, and then an even bigger generation of children that, of course, will become future workers. And so as long as you have a population pyramid, guess what? A modest-sized welfare state works. I wouldn't endorse it. I wouldn't want it. But mathematically, a modest-sized welfare state works when you have a population pyramid. But as you watch this over and over again, you see that we used to have a population pyramid, but guess what? We're living longer, which I like as I get older, but we're having fewer children. Now, people should have however many children they want to have. But unfortunately, our politicians in the 1930s and in the 1960s, they created these welfare state programs that were predicated on the assumption that we would always have a population pyramid. And as you can see, it's becoming a population cylinder. Actually, to some extent, it's becoming an upside-down pyramid. This is math. This is reality. This is baked into the cake. Although when you see, you know, the bands as you get into the future, that shows the range of options that we might see, depending on whether birth rates go up or down, or, you know, life expectancy changes a lot. But the bottom line is, there's no way under any circumstance that we're going to have anything approaching a population pyramid. We desperately need to reform the entitlement programs. I mean, we just don't have enough workers, and we're going to have too many old people. It's that simple. And again, as I said, even Hillary Clinton recognized it was a problem. Her solution, though, was simply to tax everything that moves, or for that matter, doesn't move. And that's not a very good idea. Here's a chart from the Congressional Budget Office. It just shows entitlement spending between now and 2045, just the health care programs alone. The bottom section is Medicare, and then you have Medicaid, CHIP, Obamacare on the top. And you can, and this is as a share of GDP. So when something is rising rapidly as a share of the economy, that means it's rising even more rapidly in terms of either nominal dollars or inflation-adjusted dollars. So that gives you a sign of how grim things are. Here's a chart I took from a study by the Bank for International Settlements in Switzerland. It looks at government debt between now, it's actually, well, the study's a couple of years old, but you can basically see what it's showing, between now and 2040. Not that far away. What, 23 years, if my math is correct? I mean, I'm in Washington. We don't do math in Washington. But nonetheless, I think that's 23 years. The red dotted line is what's called the baseline scenario. In other words, if we do nothing, if we just sit on our hands, that's what's going to happen to our country. Now, they measure debt as a share of GDP, which, of course, is the symptom, not the underlying problem. But what's driving those debt numbers is the rising burden of entitlement spending. So look at that debt number as a proxy for a rising burden of government spending. Now, as you're looking at this, keep in mind that Greece hit a fiscal crisis at about 115% of GDP. And we're projected to go up to over 400% of GDP. Obviously, that'll never happen. We'll have a fiscal crisis before then. But just to give you an idea of how bad our situation is, the numbers are baked into the cake because of the design of the entitlement programs and because of the demographic changes in our country. Here's a chart from the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. It's an international bureaucracy I really hate. As a matter of fact, I told some of the high-level people in the Trump administration, guys, if you can zero out the subsidies that American taxpayers give to the OECD, I'll give you a hall pass. Not the kind of hall pass that couples give each other, but a political hall pass. You get rid of subsidies for the OECD, and you do something really bad, you can call me up and say, Dan, you can't criticize this. Remember, we got rid of subsidies for the OECD. That's how much I hate the OECD. But they do have good statistics. And this chart right here shows the amount of fiscal consolidation that would have to take place on a sustained annual basis between now and 2030 to stabilize debt levels in different countries. So again, they're measuring the symptom, not the underlying disease. Let's see if I have a little, yeah, I do. The country that's in worse shape is Greece. Greece would have to do fiscal consolidation of 15% of GDP. That of course, will never happen. I mean, Greece, I mean, it's a total write-off. But nonetheless, that shows you how bad it is. The second worst country is Japan. The third worst country is Portugal. What's the fourth worst country among all developed nations? Is it Italy? Is it France? Is it Spain? No, it's the U.S. If you look at these numbers, we have to do fiscal consolidation equivalent to 9% of GDP on a sustained annual basis. Our GDP is what, $19 trillion? You're a math genius. You were in the Wall Street Journal today. What's 9% of $19 trillion? It's a lot. Yes, that was exactly it took the words right out of my mouth. Now, we have big fights in Washington. You know, Obama did a tax increase of a couple of $100 billion when we had the fiscal cliff. Imagine having to deal with at least $1.5 trillion a year of so-called fiscal consolidation. In other words, I mean, when Senator Daines was talking about they have this rule in Montana, you're in a hole, stop digging, we're in a giant chasm, and we have a giant tunnel boring machine trying to bring us to the center of the earth based on our current policies. So in other words, there's a very serious problem. And I'm telling you all this, I'm giving you all this data and all these numbers because Trump, for the love of God, he can't be serious. I hope he can't be serious about kicking the can down the road on the entitlement programs because our country will be in very, very serious shape. And God knows when Sally Pipes gets up here and talks about Obamacare, I mean, Obama's solution was, let's step on the gas. So it really is a mess, and we really are in trouble. Here's one last international bureaucracy thing. This is from the International Monetary Fund. Even if you're right up next to the chart, you won't understand it. But all you need to know is that on the horizontal axis, that's the fiscal consolidation you need to engage in, sort of like the OECD chart we just saw. And on the vertical axis, this is the built-in increase in age-related spending just between now and 2030. So in other words, this is how much spending is going up, and this is how much fiscal consolidation is needed. You don't want to be in the top right quadrant. That's all you need to understand. Who is farthest out in the top right quadrant? The United States. Now, by the way, I'm showing you all these numbers, and they all show the U.S. as being in terrible shape compared to other countries. It's actually not that bad, because you know what drives a lot of these numbers? What drives a lot of these numbers is they look at our baseline tax revenues, which on the federal level are about 19% of GDP. And they look at our projections for entitlement spending, which are going like that. And so those diverging lines, when you add up each year's deficit and then the interest on the deficit, you sort of get this, what Albert Einstein called the most powerful force in the universe, compound interest. If we actually take steps today to control government spending, these numbers dramatically change. I mean, it's like, you know, I don't know if any of you have ever gotten in trouble when you were young with credit card bills, and of course with that 18 or 21% interest, it begins to really add up, and all of a sudden you're completely underwater. That's sort of what our federal budget projections are right now, but if we never do the wasteful spending that causes the run-up in the debt in the first place, these long-run numbers become very, very manageable. Now, I say very, very manageable. It assumes politicians will do responsible things, which, of course, they normally don't like doing. We are in a race against time. That's the bottom line. The longer we wait, the closer we get to sort of the core baby boomers retiring, people like me, the harder it's going to be to solve the problems. Matter of fact, let me just show you a cartoon that I think sums it up. At some point, there are so many people with their snouts in the federal trough. I'm mixing my metaphors here because I'm showing you a pig. But at some point, you simply run out of money. This is a picture of Greece today. Greece got to a situation where you had more than 50% of the adults in the nation living off the government. And when that happens, it's not only that it's very bad economically and fiscally, but you have a very bad political culture problem. Because when 50% plus of your population is living off the government, either as government workers or as people scamming the welfare and disability programs or pensioners, people aren't getting government pensions. And by the way, my favorite story in Greece, if you work in a hazardous profession in Greece, you can retire as early as age 48 on the taxpayers. And among the hazardous professions that qualify for that in Greece is being a hairdresser. Under the theory that you're working with dyes and that somehow makes your life, you're going to get cancer or something. I don't even know what the excuse was. But the point is that Greece died because there were too many people riding in the wagon and not enough people pulling the wagon. And that's sort of the metaphor for the pig right here. Now, our friends on the left say, oh, don't worry about it because we can just raise taxes on these evil, bad people like Gene here. Well, let's actually think about it. Because, by the way, the left would love to seduce Trump into a tax increase. Oh, you're a businessman. You're used to doing deals. Why don't we do sort of an Andrews Air Force Base budget summit like George Herbert Walker Bush did in 1990? The Democrats would love that, wouldn't they? Because they got a deal that gave them more taxes and more spending. Heck, we had the Tefra budget deal in 1982. Ronald Reagan is still waiting for the $3 of spending cuts that he was promised for every dollar of tax increases. So the left would love to convince Trump, oh, you're the clever businessman. Let's just sit down in a room and hammer it out like it's a real estate deal, and we're going to sell some condominiums. That's a very, very dangerous thing to do, and I hope Trump's advisors will keep him clear from that, or at least send him in there with his Twitter account so we know what's going on. Let me go ahead and look at some of the reasons why tax increases are a bad idea. What do the Democrats want? They want higher income tax rates, but they also want higher double taxation of saving and investment. And for a public finance economist like me, I already said that worldwide taxation was sort of like sawing off your foot with a chainsaw. This is taking that chainsaw and sawing off your arms. Every economic theory in the world, even socialism, even Marxism, every economic theory in the world says you have to have saving and investing, capital formation, in other words, to finance future growth. From an agriculture perspective, you set aside your seed corn for next year's crop. I guess that's the right term, I hope. I'm not showing I'm too much of a city slicker, I hope, on that. But the point is, capital formation is a very good thing. Everyone agrees, even the Marxists, you have to have that for growth in your economy. What do we do in our tax code to people who save and invest? Let me show you a chart. Of course, you won't be able to read it, but it's very easy to explain. You earn income. Simple. You pay tax on that income. Simple. You then have after-tax income, right? Pretty simple so far. Nobody can disagree with that. What are the two things you can do with your after-tax income? You can either spend it today, or you can spend it in the future. What's another way of describing spending in the future? Saving and investing. If you spend your after-tax income right away, what does the federal government do to you? Nothing. I mean, I guess we have a federal excise tax on gasoline. There's even an excise tax on fishing tackle for some reason. There's a few little nickel and dime excise taxes, but by and large, if you take your after-tax income and you consume it right away, the federal government doesn't punish you at all. But if you save and invest your after-tax income between the capital gains tax, the corporate income tax, the double tax on dividends, and the death tax, you can be taxed as many as 3 or 4 different times. Now, you don't have to be a wild-eyed supply-side economist to think that maybe, just maybe, if the government's hitting you over the head several times for going one direction and not hitting you at all for going in the other direction, maybe, just maybe, we're discouraging and penalizing capital formation in our country. Now, when I show this flow chart to politicians, not, of course, the ones that were speaking to us today, but to the politicians, the other ones back in Washington, I see their eyes glazing over. And for a long time, I tried to figure out, how can I explain this to them where they get it? Because a lot of politicians today have no experience in the private sector. Obviously, with the congressman and the senator, we actually have people who have real-world experience, and that's great. But a lot of their colleagues, even the ones who vote the right way, sometimes have no idea how the private sector works. And so after a long time, I finally came up with this idea. I said to a politician, imagine that your business, your livelihood, was running an apple orchard. You know, maybe I should say it's almonds or something like that. But so you have this orchard, and it takes a lot of money to get your land ready, to plant the trees, to tend the trees, to protect the trees from pests and disease and everything else that happens. You have all these years of deferred income. You are sacrificing. You didn't consume that income. You saved and invested it, and you built up your orchard. And finally, after years of hard work, of sacrifice, you have a beautiful crop. Do you call things off trees crop? Okay, good, good. This is a dangerous audience because you actually know something about the real world. So you've done all this effort. You're ready to harvest your crop. How do you do that? Do you pick the crop off the trees or do you chop down the tree? And I showed the politicians these two images because even they get it. They understand that, hey, if I chop down the tree, maybe it's easier to sort of get the crop because the trees are on the ground. But even they understand that, oh, wait, but I won't have a crop next year. In this example, the tree is capital. The apples are the income. So if you're going to have a sensible tax code, and by the way, I fantasize about a world where we have no income tax whatsoever. We did just fine from 1776 to 1913 without an income tax. But again, my fantasies very rarely come true. But at least if we're going to tax income, only tax income one time, do not double and triple and quadruple tax capital. I mean, technically today, we're not actually chopping down the tree, we're sawing off limbs of the tree. But it still works out to be the same thing. Less crop next year. When you destroy your capital, you destroy your ability to generate future income. Now, just because I get the politicians to sort of, the little proverbial light bulb goes off over their head, that doesn't mean they actually change their policy and their votes, but at least I feel confident that they understand what's at stake. And by and large, to be fair, the Republicans in the 1980s, the overwhelming focus, as well it should have been, was lowering top tax rates. We had a top tax rate of 70% when Reagan took office. And actually, I have a nice little example about that in a couple of slides. We brought the top tax rate all the way down to 28%. Now, we've slipped a little bit since then. But our real problem today isn't the top income tax rate. It's all the double taxation, capital gains, death tax, et cetera, et cetera. So that's really what we need to fix. And a lot of those problems are being solved in the legislation that Trump and the House Republicans, and knock on wood, hopefully the Senate Republicans, will support. Now, I want to get back, though, to why higher taxes is not a good idea, not just for the economic reason that I already cited. I want to give you some practical reasons why higher taxes won't work. And I pulled out some evidence from the European Union. I took a 5-year average of the late 1960s and a 5-year average for the most recent years that were available. And on the left, you see tax burden as a share of GDP. So you can see that between the late 60s and the last 5 years, that the tax burden increased dramatically in Europe, mostly because they put in the value-added tax. And again, we should fight to our dying breath to make sure we never give Washington the value-added tax. But the Europeans did the value-added tax, and the tax burden grew dramatically. Now, here's what government debt was in the late 1960s, that five-year average. The politicians in Europe, just like the politicians in Washington, when they do tax increases, or just like when Jerry Brown does it, what do they always tell you? It's to balance the budget. It's to get rid of red ink. It's to control debt. It's the noble sacrifice I'm asking you people in the private sector to make so we can make our fiscal lives and our fiscal future better. Now, they get all pious, and you know, I'm surprised they're not like playing the national anthem in the background. But what happens when you give an alcoholic the keys to a liquor store? Do they have a bout of sobriety? Well, they didn't in Europe. Look at what government debt is in Europe as a share of GDP today. Dramatically higher. They didn't just spend every penny of new taxes they got. They spent every penny and then some. So even if you don't care about the economic arguments about marginal tax rates and capital formation and the sort of wonky things that public finance guys get into, just look at the practical effects. It doesn't work. You don't tax yourself into prosperity and balance. You just feed the beast of bigger government. Let me talk about something else, the Laffer curve. In Washington, and I'm not joking, well, actually, almonds, right? If you doubled the price of your almonds next year, would you expect to get twice as much revenue? Yeah. Uh-oh, he's ready to go to Washington. I'm pretty sure Gene would not double the price of his almonds and expect to get twice as much revenue because he would realize, wait, I'll lose business. So he recognizes in the real world there's a Laffer curve constraint on his ability to set prices. Well, for politicians, prices are taxes. But in Washington, when they decide they want to increase a tax rate, by and large, the revenue estimating models they have assume that there's no change in the behavior of taxpayers. That's obviously ludicrously wrong. If your tax rates doubled next year, would you work as much? Would you report as much income? Would you be more likely or less likely to try to take advantage of deductions, credits, exemptions, and other preferences in the tax code? Of course your behavior changes. So you can't just look at tax rates to estimate tax revenues. You have to look at tax rates to then estimate taxable income and then estimate tax revenues. And I want to show you this thing called the Laffer curve. How much money do you collect at 100% tax rate? Nothing, because who's going to earn income? Well, maybe there are some genetic communists out there, so maybe it's not quite nothing, but it's going to be pretty close to zero. I know I would not wake up and go to work if I didn't get to keep any money from my labor. On the other hand, if the tax rate is zero, what does the government collect? Nothing. So obviously, at some point between a 0% tax rate and a 100% tax rate, you have this thing called the Laffer curve. Even Paul Krugman, by the way, agrees with this. The difference is that Paul Krugman would draw the chart or the line so it's more like this. He says the revenue maximizing point is more like 70 to 80%. So we all agree on the Laffer curve. We just disagree on the various inflection points. But you know what? Never in my life have I woken up and thought to myself, how can I maximize revenue for Washington? Never. I am not interested in this revenue maximizing point. I am interested in the growth maximizing point. The growth maximizing point is where we raise enough revenue to finance the few legitimate functions of the federal government, which I guess is maybe a Pentagon and whatnot. Who was the, who's the guy on that Parks and Recreation? Ron Swanson. Yeah. He says he wants the federal government to basically be one guy in a room deciding who to nuke. I'm a little more left-wing than he is, you know. Maybe have an FBI too or something like that. But the point is that's the only amount of revenue you want to collect, enough to finance legitimate functions of government. And I want to show you a real world example of this. I already mentioned in 1980 that we had a top tax rate in the United States of 70%. Now, by the way, every year the IRS publishes something called the Statistics of Income Bulletin. And it's actually a very rich, detailed source of data. You can look at how much income was reported at different income levels, the sources of the income, the credits and deductions and exemptions that they utilized. And so what I did is I looked at people making more than $200,000 a year, because they were the ones affected by these top tax rates. So in 1980, with the top tax rate of 70%, we had about 117,000 of these so-called rich people. They reported $36 billion of income to the IRS, and Uncle Sam got $19 billion. This is when our top tax rate was 70%. Ronald Reagan, in his 8 years, lowered that top tax rate to 28%. Now, the Ted Kennedys of the world and people like that said, oh, this is unfair. Rich people won't pay enough. The Treasury will be starved of revenue. We can't do this. And, you know, they'd sort of be, you know, rending their shirts and, you know, hitting themselves with what are those things that the Iranians do? You know, so they predicted doom and gloom and horrible things were going to happen. Well, let's go to the 1988 Statistics of Income Bulletin. And actually, before I put up those numbers, we're going to do a class participation quiz. And whoever wins this, Jennifer and Rick will give you a free pass in next year's, well, maybe you won't, I can't speak for them. But if you get it right, you'll deserve a free pass. So in 1980, these rich people making more than $200,000 a year paid $19 billion to the IRS at a 70% tax rate. So $19 billion, 70% tax rate. Tax rate comes down to 28%. What happened to revenue in 1988 from people making more than $200,000 a year? Up? What are you, some sort of crazy supply sider? I mean, the Joint Committee on Taxation says revenue will go down, not up. Okay, so people are saying up. Anybody want to hazard a specific guess? It's like the Price is Right. $52 billion. Wow, that's like more than doubling when rates are much lower. And is he the only person who wants to get? $200 billion? Oh, she's on crack. I mean, share some of that stuff with me after my speech. I mean, you actually sort of spoiled this for me, because everyone guesses like $25 billion, $30 billion, $50 billion, and you say $200 billion because the actual number was $99.7 billion. But now it doesn't sound as dramatic because you said $200 billion. Thanks a lot. Security, get her out of the room. But think about it. Notwithstanding the fact that she stepped on my punchline, five times as much revenue when the rate went from 70% down to 28%. Now, we had 44% inflation during the period. We had 78% population growth. We had other reforms that Reagan was doing that would have led to more rich people, more taxable income. But you can see what sort of happened. We got a lot more rich people and 10 times as much taxable income. And that's why revenues increased five times. In other words, people's behavior does change when the tax code changes. And that's why all the good things, not the border adjustable provision, but everything else in the House plan that Congressman Nunez was talking about is wonderful. And even most of the, almost all the provisions in the Trump plan. So somehow, if we can figure out how to sort of restrain the growth of government spending so we can get through a very good tax cut and tax reform agenda, we will have much faster growth in the United States. Here's my sort of little, I have the tree thing for capital formation. Here's my little image about just the incentive effects of marginal tax rates. Politicians all the time, we need higher taxes on tobacco because we want people to smoke less. And then I say to them, okay, I'm a libertarian. I don't want to control people's private lives, but I give you an A+ for microeconomics. So tell me, if you understand that higher taxes on tobacco will lead to less smoking, what's the impact of higher taxes on work, saving, investment, and entrepreneurship? Then they sort of, ooh, we're sort of trapped here. And they sort of, they sort of look up at the ceiling, check their fingernails. But the reality is, of course, taxes affect behavior. So we need to have tax rates as low as possible. There's no such thing as a pro-growth tax. But there is such a thing as a tax that doesn't do as much damage as the alternatives. And that's what we're trying to do in Washington. I mentioned before that the real solution is to reduce the burden of government spending. Here are examples that I took from the IMF's World Economic Outlook database of countries that for multi-year periods had government growing less than 2% a year. That's sort of that middle column. This is the, these are the years that the spending restraint took place. This is the average increase in the government spending in nominal terms. Look what happened to government spending as a share of GDP. Remember, that's the underlying disease, the brain tumor. And then here's the symptom, deficits as a share of GDP. In other words, anytime a government anywhere in the world manages to impose some spending restraint, you get very good results. And when I'm debating my left-wing friends in Washington, I say to them, can you put up your table showing the countries that have gotten good results from tax increases? And you begin to hear the crickets chirping and stuff like this. In other words, we have real-world evidence on our side. Spending restraint works. I showed you the European evidence of what happens with the tax increase option. There are no success stories of higher taxes and bigger government. It's just, you know, we've heard about the road to Greece. It's not a very good place to be on. Now, the Congressional Budget Office, and I'll go ahead and shut up on this, because I don't know how long I've been talking, but hopefully there's time for some good Q&A. The Congressional Budget Office, just a couple of weeks ago, released their new 10-year forecast. I took those 10-year numbers, because this is the baseline of what's going to happen to revenues over the next 10 years, basically growing about, you know, almost 5% a year. This is where government spending is right now. If we have government spending grow 1% a year, we balance the budget in like 5 years. If government grows 2% a year, we balance the budget in 7 years. If we let government grow 2.63% a year, we balance it in 10 years. Now, again, my goal is not balancing the budget. I mean, that's a good thing. My goal is shrinking the burden of government relative to the private sector. That's what gives you economic growth and economic benefits. But I'm simply making the point. When you have politicians in Washington saying, oh, there's no way we can balance the budget unless we have tax increases, that's nonsense. A modest amount of spending restraint balances the budget. But some of you are thinking, well, don't we want to cut taxes as well? Yeah, we do. What if we were to do the House Better Way plan is on a static basis, I think, a $2 trillion tax cut. But I don't like that border adjustable provision, so let's take that out and make it a $3 trillion tax cut in static terms. What would have to happen if we wanted to balance the budget and do a $3 trillion tax cut over the next 10 years? Do we have to cut programs 20%, 30%? I mean, I'd love that to happen, by the way. I mean, why do we have a Department of Housing and Urban Development? No one's ever explained that to me. But let's set that aside. $3 trillion tax cut and balance the budget in 10 years if we do what? Simply have government grow 1.96% a year. This red line is the new revenue trend line with a $3 trillion tax cut. In other words, about $300 billion less of revenue every year. And this is what has to happen. This is where spending is right now. If you want these two lines to meet out here, I sort of feel like a financial forecaster for your company here. You want these two lines to meet, have government grow 1.96% a year. Now, that makes it seem very simple. It's not. Well, actually, it is simple, but it's not easy. Because if you want government spending to grow 1.96% a year, you're going to have to do something with entitlement programs because they're currently projected to grow like 6, 7, 8% a year. So it does require you to make some changes to the underlying structure of government programs, and maybe, just maybe, it's time to separate the wheat from the chaff and get rid of some of these programs, including the OECD subsidies that I already talked about. So it's not easy, but it is simple if you simply restrain government spending. What did I just do there? Do I want to deny or do I want to allow? I don't know. There's something on this screen here, but you don't have it on there. Three takeaways. We have a very, very bad future if we leave everything on autopilot. Hopefully you remember those charts that showed that. There are good solutions. Simply have some spending restraint, but it's not going to be easy. The interest groups in Washington will squeal, and all their lobbyists will squeal. And you'll have those protesters out there. It'll be the same thing all over again in Washington. They'll have marches on Washington, protests, the so-called Washington Monument Syndrome. It'll be a big fight. And it ultimately all comes down to Donald Trump. Will he be a patriot in the proper sense and do what is best for the country, even if it means short-term political heat for him? I hope he is. Victor's presentation makes me more optimistic than I've been in the last 6 months. But frankly, time will tell. And with that, I'll go ahead and stop and be happy to take questions until the bosses tell me I have to get off the stage. Thank you very much. Okay, until Jennifer says shut up, we'll take questions. And we have one right there.
Hello, my name is Tom Cox. I'm curious what you think is likely to get passed between Trump's plan and the Ryan plan. What do you think's rational that will get through? And then the second part of that is, if you could wave the magic wand from a taxing standpoint, what would that be?
Well, if I could wave a magic wand, we'd go back to pre-1913 and not have an income tax whatsoever. In the context of the modern world, I would wave a magic wand and do a flat tax, because that's sort of the gold standard of tax reform. Now, by the way, some people say, why not a national sales tax? All right, if you get rid of the 16th Amendment and replace it with something so ironclad that even Ruth Bader Ginsburg and John Roberts can't rationalize that an income tax is constitutional, sure, I'll take that too. I mean, they're basically two sides of the same coin. A flat tax taxes your income one time at one low rate when you earn it. A national sales tax or fair tax taxes your income one time at one low rate when you spend it. No double taxation, low rates, no loopholes, the least destructive possible way to raise revenue. So that's what I would like. Now, first part of your question is, what's the maybe the best case scenario for what might happen? The House plan is great. I mean, I have a problem with the border adjustable provision, and that's why I said let's do a $3 trillion tax cut instead of a $2 trillion tax cut. I would just say to Trump, hey, Donald, take the House plan, have them strip out the border adjustable provision, which, by what is that? I should have explained that. That basically would say we're going to deny any import. We would tax all imports coming into the country by basically making them non-deductible to the people buying them. So Walmart buys stuff from overseas. They get no tax deduction, which, of course, they should. I mean, when you're a business, what's your taxable income? It should be the difference between your total revenue and your total cost. The Better Way plan says you can't recognize the cost of any imports. And you also get this big all export income is exempt from tax. So it's sort of protectionist, but they say it's not protectionist because currencies will adjust. The US dollar will go up by 25%, and therefore it'll be sort of the same. But because we have a trade deficit, we'll get this $1 trillion plus of revenue. Lots of problems politically with the plan. I think it's just better if they take that part out, do a bigger tax cut. But the House plan is really a very well-designed plan, other than that one feature that gives me a little bit of heartburn. Again, one of my problems is that it would be very easy for a future left-wing Congress and administration to turn it into a VAT. And as I said before, that's the point in time when all of you should look up Australian citizenship, because there'll be no hope of ever reforming entitlements and controlling government if they have a new source of revenue.
Maybe just one more, Dan.
Okay. Make it a good one.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Mark Turman. I have a question of the total amount of revenue raised by taxes. How much revenue comes from those items that are double and triple taxed of the total amount? What percentage?
Well, the easy part of that question is that the death tax raises less than 1% of revenue. It's only one half of 1%. And it does probably more damage than anything else on a per dollar collected basis. So get rid of it. It's just an asterisk in terms of tax revenue. Things like capital gains, they're harder to measure because they're sort of embedded in the income tax numbers. Now, if I looked at this year's or the most recent year's statistics of income bulletin, I might be able to give you an answer, but I haven't done that. And capital gains is very cyclical. So some years it might only be $50 billion. Some years it might be $500 billion, because frankly, it depends on the value of financial assets. Some years they're going up. Some years they're going down. And you see that, by the way, in California. Your tax revenues are so cyclical from the income tax because you get some incredibly high share from the top 1%. And of that top 1%, a lot of it's capital gains. So when the market is down, California goes into a fiscal toilet. When the market's up, then Jerry Brown can spend a little bit. Or I guess, is he gone now? Oh, he's not gone yet? Well, all right, sorry about that. I didn't mean to bring up something bad and grim. But with that, I've been told I have to shut up. I'd be happy to answer questions in the hallway. Thank you very much.